All right, Crystal, what's on your radar?
Well, while the burning embers of Russiagate never died from 2016, it is already being stoked back into a raging fire for 2020, as if this year wasn't already awesome enough. But this time, there is a little bit of a twist. On Friday, Bill Evanina, the nation's top counterintelligence official, revealed that Russia was once again trying to meddle in the presidential election by targeting, this time, Joe Biden. But he also expanded on their assessment that China and Iran both favor Biden. Now, news outlets, of course, went to great lengths to portray the Russian threat as qualitatively different than the Chinese and Iranian threats. But that is not how counterintelligence officials are actually portraying it. In fact, the NSA co-lead of a joint election security task force with U.S. Cyber Command explicitly rejected such a comparison, saying, Russia, China, Iran, they all have intent and they all do activities that they think are advancing their best interest. I don't think I would say one is scarier than the other, per se. But Nancy Pelosi and Adam Schiff will hear none of it, although they've spent years now venerating the infallible heroes of the national security blob. Suddenly they've developed minds of their own. Here's Pelosi bristling at the idea that foreign interference might be a mixed bag this cycle.
China would prefer Joe Biden, whether they do. That's their conclusion, that they would prefer Joe Biden. Russia is actively 24/7 interfering in our election. They did so in 2016, and they are doing so now. And they say that to a certain extent, but they need to tell the American people more. The American people, I believe, think they should decide who the president of the United States is, not Vladimir Putin making that decision for us.
Why so ruffled, Nancy? Well, you see, even though Biden is up in the polls, even though they have confidently assured the voting public that he is oh so electable, even though they've brought in a dream team of right-wing reactionaries like Anna Navarro and John Kasich to make the case, truth is, they aren't feeling as confident as one might hope. After all, these folks actually know Joe Biden. They've seen his flaws up close. They've watched his decline up close. There is a reason why there was so much foot dragging among the Dem establishment around lining up behind Biden when it should have been an absolute no-brainer. He's the former two-term VP of the first black president. The fact that his nomination was taken as anything other than an obvious inevitability tells you everything you need to know about their confidence in his capabilities. And so, they've got to get their excuses ready in case he loses, because the last thing they can afford is to have another bedrock neoliberal corporatist go down in flames to the Trumpster and have people actually ascribe that loss to their bankrupt ideology. So just like in 2016, they've got to have their excuses for losing all lined up. What will be this year's Comey in Russia and Jill Stein in sexism? Well, last cycle's excuses worked so well that the new line is quite derivative, frankly. After all, they managed to not only convince most of the resistance liberal set that Hillary's loss wasn't really Hillary's fault and certainly wasn't neoliberalism's fault, they actually convinced those same people that to even discuss any problems with the neoliberal program is racist. And in a maneuver that is truly awe-inspiring in its audacity, the Dem establishment even managed to convince Democrats to nominate Hillary 2.0 on the promise of electability, even though Biden's most closely aligned ideological kin just got destroyed in a gimme election, which is kind of the opposite of electability. I mean, you have to respect the game in a way, even if that game is tearing the country apart and keeping it firmly in the clutches of the tyranny of either the well-moneyed or well-educated elite. All right, so they've got Russiagate revving up and are indignantly insisting that Russia is the only country whose interference actually counts. I mean, after all, what other nation could possibly compete with the brilliance of their impeccable buff Bernie memes? Captain of this one, right, I had to get this in there. There is a new coloring book calling Buff Bernie a coloring book for Berniacs, is full of very attractive doodles of Bernie Sanders in muscle poses. The coloring is something that suits for all people. That alone was probably good for a few 10,000 votes or so in Pennsylvania. But they're not relying on Russiagate alone. No, no, no. With Biden picking a female running mate, sexism is still in the mix this year as a quality excuse for failing to beat one of the worst presidents of all time. Maureen Dowd wrote a simply flawless column this weekend reminding voters that it had been 36 years since a man and a woman had run atop a presidential ticket. Except, of course, that last cycle, a man and a woman ran together atop a presidential ticket. New York Times, always quick on the ball, they edited the story in their corresponding tweet to indicate it had been 36 years since a man had selected a woman to be his running mate. Except, of course, for that whole John McCain and Sarah Palin situation, New York Times is not sending their best. Nevertheless, Maureen persisted, writing, "We don't know whom Biden will choose, but we do know the sort of hell she will endure at the hands of Team Trump. Even after the hashtag MeToo revolution, even with women deciding this election, have the undercurrents of sexism in America changed so much? Kind of weird that a column about sexism would almost completely erase Sarah Palin, and also rather convenient that sexism was never posited as the reason for McCain-Palin's defeat. Bless her heart. But wait, there's more. I mean, you really got to bring your A-game if you're going to avoid having your entire ideology and multi-decades-long project of selling out the working class tossed in the dustbin of history, where it most certainly belongs, for a second straight time. Jill Stein is not running, and none of the other third-party candidates were really showing too much promise as potential spoilers. And good Lord, Bernie has certainly more than bent the knee. But now they've got Kanye. Sure, he's in the middle of a public health mental breakdown and has pretty much failed to do any of the basics of campaigning, like, oh, say, trying to obtain ballot access. But still, there are maybe some Republicans involved, and he gave a kind of a vague answer about being a spoiler, and oh my God, Kanye is this year's Jill Stein and Susan Sarandon put together. And never fear, my friends, the fact that Bernie has been utterly declawed and fully bowed down before the Dem establishment doesn't mean that leftists won't still be blamed for a Biden defeat. After all, while oldsters seem ready to back Biden, his numbers have stayed soft with young voters. If they don't throw on their aviators and Soul of America t-shirts and ecstatically line up at their COVID super spreader election sites, then the damn hippies have effectively doomed the country to fascism again. Couldn't possibly be that the public has once again rejected the hollow, destructive shell of neoliberalism. They would never do that. And Sagar, I have to say,
yeah.
I mean, you see all those excuses lining up. You see the polls are starting to tighten a little.
Yes.
This thing is not in the bag.
No, it's not. Now, I mean, look, last month, I think we were looking at a 10-point spread. I checked the Real Clear Politics average this morning, 6.5. 6.5 is around where Hillary was. In fact, I think on 2 days ago, the RCP polling average was exactly the same for Biden as it was for Hillary at that exact date in 2016. Not where it had been previously. That's a disaster, right? That's very bad for Biden, which means now you're in that 50-50 category. And yeah, they're already lining it up. I mean, it's what we saw before coronavirus, which I thought basically handing Biden the bag. And I'm like, how do you screw this up so monumentally?
Absolutely.
And you look at that Pelosi clip is so incredible. She's like, well, China, but Russia somehow qualitatively different. Everybody here knows I don't like China. I'm a China hawk or whatever. You think that if Biden won that we'd be like, oh, China is the reason that Joe Biden is president. You'd be like, no, I think it has 10x more to do with Trump being like coronavirus isn't a problem in late February.
I mean,
I think that's probably like the main reason he would lose.
In
right?
fairness, I yeah. certainly see Trump and plenty of the Republicans going and picking it up
sure.
and being like, it was China. I mean, let's not pretend that they're good actors on this side. But I think your point is so correct, which is, look at where we are. I mean, we just passed 5 million infected with coronavirus, hospitalizations, deaths. I mean, we're looking at 200, 300,000 Americans who may die of coronavirus completely unchecked. You look at the economy, the utter failure, abdication of leadership, the fact that you've got 30% of renters who can't make their August payment are going to be potentially forced down the street. Eviction protections have expired. And you're like barely beating this guy. I mean, if you're not winning handily right now, because normally the way this works is it narrows down the stretch. And, you know, President Trump will do some equivalent of the migrant caravan he did back in 2018. Red state voters will come back into the fold who were a little squishy there. Mm-hmm. And if he's in shooting, if he's within striking distance, you're in big trouble. And so I don't think the Democrats feel Joe Biden has it in the bag. And the fact that he has been so absent, that he is so unable to articulate anything, the bar has been set so low that you're not destroying this guy right now, given everything that's unfolding and the total failures of leadership, like, that's a real alarm bell is going off.
It just shows their sheer insecurity, the Russia thing, the Kanye thing, you know, so everything that you pointed out there. It just shows that they are so insecure in their own candidate that they're like, oh my gosh, young black voters might vote for Kanye over Biden, ergo Kanye is a GOP plan. It's like, well, wait, or you could work harder in order to win over the votes of young black voters, right? Am I the crazy one here? I remember this with Ross Perot. HW hated Ross Perot. He's like, he cost me the election. I'm like, maybe NAFTA cost you the election, man.
Right, how about that?
Maybe NAFTA. Maybe, you know, Reaganomics. Maybe so much of how you conducted yourself during the presidency. They never, ever grapple with that. They always have to blame the person. And they always blame people for voting how they feel. I mean, how can you do such a thing in an American democracy? But that's how it is today.
They never, never, ever self-reflect. And it is miraculous the way that they turn it around and avoided any culpability whatsoever.
Oh, yeah,
and just lined it all up to replay the same playbook all over again.
I wish I could be one of them, just fail over and over and over again and just blame somebody else.
And get promoted.
Yeah,
that's the way that works over on that
strategy.
Side. All right, Sagar, looking forward to your radar. That's next.